Welcome to Full Steam Ahead, a podcast about Purdue. On this episode, it is my privilege to welcome in the athletic director of Purdue University, Mike Bobinski. Mike, welcome to the Full Steam Ahead podcast. How are you doing?
Great. Adam, thanks for having me. Appreciate it.
Yeah, I appreciate your time. I know you are a very busy man up there, especially this time of year. So very grateful for your time today. Let's talk about what's going on right now. It's an exciting time because we actually at least have football right now in your world up there for sports. At least we have something. Obviously, we'd love to have all the fall sports going on right now, but this is where we are at with the COVID challenges. But talk about the excitement of actually having some football to watch right now.
Well, it was, you know, it was great last Saturday, even though it was different. It was sort of surreal to be in Ross Aid with, you know, just literally a smattering of people, but the opportunity for our team, our coaches and everybody to actually compete is something that they have invested a whole lot in order to get to that point successfully. And obviously we were without some key pieces, our head coach and a few others for sure. But, you know, I can tell you that the excitement level for our guys, the anticipation leading up to game day, and then the pure sort of joy after that game was over, and we were obviously fortunate enough to win, was something great to see and something we've missed for a long time here. We hadn't had a competition since March. That's the last time we've done anything. And so, you know, there was no certainty that we were even going to get to that point, but it certainly felt good when we got there, no doubt about it.
Yes, for sure. Just getting to see him out on the field and being thankful for that. But a win always helps it even make it a little more sweeter, doesn't it?
Yes, it does. No denying that.
And remarkable, too. You mentioned, you know, the head coach isn't there. Arguably your best player's not there and a couple other injuries and guys not there. And still able to maintain that poise and come back and win that in the fourth quarter.
Yeah, we chose to take the hard way to victory there on Saturday, and you know it was a hard fought game. I was always extremely well coached and well prepared and hard nosed team, and they were all the above on Saturday. They made some mistakes that are uncharacteristic, and you know, to our credit, we took advantage of them and we're in a position to win down the stretch, and we're able to finish it off, which was a great way to start the season. No way to deny how good that felt to get it started with a late fourth quarter win was a really good feeling.
And kudos to Aiden O'Connell. I know a lot of people are maybe surprised by the fact that he started, but that he also not only started, played the whole game and finished the game. And kudos to him. He maintained his poise. I know there's a couple times in the game, myself included, like maybe should they change it up just to see if that changes the tempo or anything, but they stuck with him and it paid off, right?
Yeah, you know, if Aiden is above all, he's a really composed young guy who doesn't let whatever happened on the previous series or the previous snap sort of affect the next one, and that showed itself, I think, yet again in down the stretch there on Saturday, because he'll be the first to tell you, you know, he wasn't perfect, particularly in the middle of that game. You know, he had some rough series out there where it just wasn't working the way he'd like it to. But you know, I think his teammates have great confidence in him. I think, as they do in Jack and in Austin Burton, I think we're fortunate this year where I think we've got legitimately three quarterbacks that we feel like could run out there and do well for us. Aiden happened to bubble up to the top, but those guys pull for each other in a really unique and cohesive way, which is not the way it always is. But boy, he's really good under pressure. Aiden is, and we saw yet another example of that on Saturday.
Right. Well, again, thankful that we're going to actually play some games, and yeah. Purdue has been very fortunate and blessed to have no players test positive, and outside of Coach Brahms last week, yeah. We've been able to maintain that, you know, the low rate there for sports, and of course the team, like I said, was zero test. Unfortunately, not the case up in Madison, and yeah. We're already seeing the effect of that with their game being canceled this weekend against Nebraska. Right. Any concerns as you see that news of what it can mean going forward, especially since Purdue plays Wisconsin the following week?
Yeah, you know, I feel obviously really badly for both Wisconsin and Nebraska not being able to play the game this week. Everybody has invested lots of energy and time and discipline and given up lots of things in order to get ourselves to this point of being able to play and to have the number of cases that Wisconsin had, where they felt it was the smart thing to do to shut down for this week. Is a shame. I mean, it really is. Nobody feels good about that. They're obviously a really good team. They're always a really good team, and they want to play football. I mean, they didn't do this for any reason other than they must have absolutely been convinced that this is the best way to contain any further outbreak. And that's really the key to our ability to play next week is containing the any further transmission within their group. If they're able to do that and their numbers come down and their rolling averages are in a better place come next Tuesday, then my guess is we'll play that game up at Wisconsin next weekend. That's our hope for sure. And I'm certain that that is Wisconsin's intention. They are not looking to not play games. We've all worked too hard to get to this point to try to not have games happen. They'll do everything possible as long as it's safe and as long as they're putting their guys in a good position to be able to play next weekend. And we're hopeful that'll happen.
Yeah, for sure. Yeah, hopefully that is the key. Let's ruin one game to hopefully save the rest. That will work across the board for the Big Ten and of course across all the conferences. Looking forward towards winter. I know, obviously basketball and these other sports are starting to practice. What's your hope that we'll be able to see a fairly normal winter sports season?
Well, I think, the next up are the two basketballs, men's and women's basketball. They're practicing. They are now undergoing the same daily testing regimen that football has been doing since September 30th. So that's a good thing to help manage the transmission and to keep it contained so people don't become infectious or we catch them before they get to the infectious stage so it doesn't spread any further. But I'm hopeful that basketball will come off well. We're excited about both of our teams. There's still lots of unknowns about really finalizing schedule. We're close on the men's side. I think we're still working through it on the women's side. Whether or not we'll be able to play in front of any fans is yet to be determined. There's lots of things yet to figure out, but I'm optimistic that we will have a really good and complete basketball season, complete being less than a regular year, but complete based on a sort of the shortened version that's been put forward this year. And again, that will be, I think, good for us. I think we'll be really competitive. The league on the men's side will be maybe the best Big Ten men's basketball collection of teams that we've ever had. I think there are 10, maybe more teams that I think legitimately have a chance to be really, really good. And that should make for some entertaining contests during the winter. And I just hope some people can see them. That'd make it even more fun.
Yeah, for sure. I love basketball so much and excited for Coach Painter and Coach Versa, their young squads they got and just the bright future those programs have. So hopefully we get to see that. And fans especially, I probably obviously because of COVID won't be able to be sellouts, which obviously is the advantage we have at Mackey Arena with how loud it can get in there. But just even be able to have some in there would obviously, I think, still make an impact.
Yes, sir. It absolutely would. And I mean, we're hopeful. But you know what? That'll all depend on circumstances that we can't control. We gotta do what we can do, and the environment around us will ultimately dictate whether or not fans can. Everyone will be comfortable with fans coming in at some level. It would obviously not be what we're all used to, but having some presence in there would be great if it's workable at the right time.
For sure. Well, unfortunately, COVID made a huge impact, especially financially, on Purdue athletics, dating all the way back to last March. Talk about this. In August, you guys launched this More Than a Game campaign. Talk about that.
We and so many others, and I think all of college athletics is feeling a significant financial crunch here as a result of this virus and all that it's taken away from us and forced us to really make some really difficult decisions. We've had to make difficult personnel decisions. We have done without in lots of other areas to try to put ourselves in a position that we can be solvent through this whole year. But even with all the different actions that we took, it was clear that wasn't going to be enough to solve the problem in and of itself. There just weren't enough levers I could pull to get ourselves to a solvent position. So that's why we launched the More Than a Game campaign. And I couldn't be more pleased with the response that we've gotten from the Purdue community. They've recognized the reality of our situation. I think they recognize that over many years, we're not we don't spend thoughtlessly. We're very careful with our resources. We try to be really good stewards of the resources that we do get. And if we say we've got a problem, it's a legitimate problem. It's not cutting into just fat and fluff. It's cutting into muscle and bone. And we want our program to come out the other side of this virus experience strong and ready to compete and not be handicapped by having to take on debt or, you know, really have this turn into a multi-year problem. So again, the More Than a Game campaign is our effort to try to fill that hole that is otherwise unfillable at this point. And while we've made good progress and we continue to make good progress, there's room yet to go. But I'm confident. I think our fans and our people, the Purdue people, they get it. They understand. They want to be supportive. You know, some of them are dealing with their own tough circumstances, but those that are in a position to help have helped, and I think we'll continue to help as we work to again keep ourselves in a really good spot. And you know, fortunately for us, you know, I think you've seen sort of the cut both ways sword here. The people in our league, and for instance, that have the 100,000 seat football stadiums, Ohio State, Penn State, Michigan, the impact of losing game days for them, while it's significant for us, for sure, it's millions for us, tens of millions. For them, it's even more significant. It's 50 to 75, in some cases, almost $100 million. And, you know, those are staggering numbers to try to figure out how to mitigate in the course of a year while you're sort of in motion. It's almost an impossible puzzle to solve. Ours is daunting for sure, but maybe not quite as challenging as some of our colleagues. And and I feel for them. I mean, these are not easy times. And, we're looking at our finances literally every day to determine sort of where we are and projecting how we might be able to get through this.
Yeah, you mentioned the revenue from game day. Obviously, we have games now, no fans, only a family. So while helpful, I would assume still only a minimal impact of helping, or is there a lot from media revenue from television games?
Well, the media rights deal is a really important piece of our revenues for sure. And that's not anywhere near 100%. I mean, we lost games, and our media partners lost the opportunity to provide the inventory to their to their broadcast and distribution outlets. So by definition, I think it's a sort of a math problem. You lose 20% or 30% of your games, you're gonna have a reduction in your media rights, and those are real dollars and significant dollars. So we're hopeful that it will stay in a reasonably good place, but that's all dependent on us being able to play the rest of our football season as it's currently scheduled, to be able to play basketball as it's currently scheduled. And those are things that neither one of us can know at this point, Adam. We can hope, and we're all hoping, but we can't know that for sure.
All right. You mentioned the response has been good so far. Can you talk about the progress? I believe you guys updated pretty recently that the goal is at least 18 million.
Yes.
Where we're at so far.
Yeah, I think when we did that recent update communication piece, we said that we had raised more than 5 million. I think we're closing in on 6 at this point, so we're continuing to make what is good progress. But when you've still got 2/3 of the way to go, there's room and work that needs to be done, room to improve, and the progress we will continue to push hard to make again, with the hope of containing this thing to just this year, if we can help it.
For sure. Of course, we know Boilermakers. We've got a great fan base, great alumni, and of course, the John Purdue Club that plays a significant impact in this. So just kind of a call out for all of us to join together and help this. One other thing I want to hit on this, it's called More Than a Game, and it's because it is, because we want to put the emphasis on student athlete and the monies that don't come from outside, sources for the student athletes. And then also one thing I really love from the video put out in August is, like people like Tyler Trent, and I thought that was so awesome, but also important that you included things like that in that video to show that it's more than just what happens in between the lines or, final score on the scoreboard, but there's so much more to that. Can you talk about that?
Yeah. And I'm glad you brought that up, Adam. That's a great point. And that's really the focus of what we've done when competition was uncertain, when the ability to even practice was uncertain. We still had a commitment to our student athletes that we made when they came to Purdue, that we were going to do everything in our power to, number one, provide them a great academic experience, to give them a Purdue education, which is a tremendous quality and great value to them. But beyond that, to help them develop as young people in every way, to have career opportunities, personal development opportunities, ways to engage in the issues that arose in our country during this summer, to be able to have productive ways to express themselves and to be part of part of positive change. You know, so all of that has been a great emphasis for us. And we've continued to provide medical support and mental health support and nutrition support and academic advising and support. So all those things, none of that went away, even though competition wasn't what we were used to and it was definitely reduced. All those commitments were things that we didn't want to back off on at all. And we haven't, you know, we've lived up to every bit of that. In fact, our engagement with our athletes and their participation in our sort of value-added programming, all those personal and career development opportunities has been the highest it's been in ever. And so hopefully that's a trend that will continue once we move post-virus here. But you know, we've really focused on that, and those are things that that are really being helped by this More Than a Game campaign, and I think we'll pay great benefits for our young people in years to come.
Right on. All right. Thank you for kind of explaining that, go more in depth on that. Yeah. Also, I did mention Tyler Trent. A couple years into your tenure here, the big impact that he made. Talk about just the impact and the publicity Purdue got from Tyler Trent's just amazing story.
Yeah, you know, Tyler is a young man who, you know, it's one in a, I can't tell you how many that who have such a special quality about him and a selflessness and an ability to be concerned for, you know, the future of so many others beside himself. Even though, you know, when he knew that his situation was in dire straits, where he, you know, there was no real hope that he would have an extended ability to be with us, you know, his focus completely turned on how do I spread the word so that others in a similar circumstance can be best helped. And that's I mean, that is just a unique mindset and a maturity way beyond his years, and you know, in a perspective and all that we all, I think I, to this day, I envy that, how he gets there, how he got there, and, you know, at his young age is just an amazing thing. You know, and his connection to athletics, his, you know, his love for Purdue sports and his connection to particularly our football program was something very, very special. And it's hard to actually imagine that, you know, that Ohio State game back in 2018 and, you know, all that happened that sort of came together in such a unique way on national television with, you know, with his participation and his influence that evening, that there wasn't something special. That was just an ingredient that was going to be hard to beat that night. And, you know, all of us that watched that were part of it. I was fortunate enough to be in the stadium and to feel it. It was a moment that I don't think anyone will ever forget, and we all owe him and continue to owe him a debt of gratitude for the way he elevated the cause of pediatric cancer and the money that continues to be raised in his memory and to sort of honor his legacy is a great thing and will be helpful to so many others in the years to come.
Awesome. Yeah, and one other way you guys honored him was the T2 gate there, the student gate. Talk about the significance of doing that.
Yeah, you know, again, he's you know, he was such a symbol of hope and sort of that Boilermaker spirit of perseverance and grit, and you know, we wrestled with what's the right way to keep that legacy with us for years to come. And I think you know, that embodies the Purdue student spirit in so many ways, and you know, and having his presence at the gate where the students enter for generations to come is, I think, a great reminder to all of us and to our students as to how to live a life and how to be concerned for things beyond yourself. And we thought it was a really appropriate gesture, and we were fortunate to have great partners join with us in helping that gate come together. And I think it's awesome. I mean, it really, I still, you know, at all times, I still see people visiting campus, even in this time, taking pictures in front of that gate, in front of the plaque, and it's meaningful to lots of Purdue people. Yeah. And others too.
Yeah, for sure. I mean, even people outside the Purdue community. Yeah. Really cool thing you guys did out there. So I, as a friend of the family, I just really appreciate all the love and support you've given to the Trent family. It's really cool. Well, outside of the challenges of COVID-19, I was kind of curious to kind of get your thoughts on kind of the state of Purdue sports, whether it be, you know, on the playing field or facilities, kind of where you feel you guys are at as a university.
Sure. I would say this, Adam. I think from a facilities perspective, there are always things you want to get done and what you want to accomplish. So that's sort of a never-ending list of opportunities to continue to improve. And we've got men's, women's basketball locker room projects that we want to get done. There are video board projects out at baseball and softball we want to get done. We were fortunate to unveil the new video board in Ross Aid to 800 screaming fans on Saturday. But it did its part. It looked awesome. And I just can't wait for others and, for a full stadium to be able to experience that. But there are other things for sure that we'd like to get done. And obviously the Ross Aid project was one that we were in the planning stages on before this virus came upon us and really put that on the shelf for lots of good reasons and appropriate reasons at this point. Our focus is on keeping our department together right now. But the desire to continue to improve Ross Aid and to make it a place that really provides a tremendous home field advantage and is a stadium that will be serviceable and attractive and again be a great place to compete and attract both fans and players for years to come is still there for us. And once we emerge from all this, that project will once again be front burner for us. And I can't predict when that might be, but it will be there at some point in time. In general, though, beyond the facility side of things, I would tell you I like where our program's going. I think there's a sense of positive and forward movement and momentum. We've got a group of coaches that I believe have a great sense of pride and belief in what we can accomplish here at Purdue athletically. We're fortunate to be able to attract just terrific young people here. They're so well balanced. They've got great perspective. They've got substance to them. And at the end of the day, I believe you win with people like that. Young people of character are at the end of the day will ultimately be very, very successful. And so I think we've got programs that are headed towards great success in the years ahead. And I would tell you just a couple of them that were relocated from the fall. Our volleyball program, our women's soccer program, I think both of those are poised to be really, really successful. Yeah. Years ahead. Volleyball has been good for a long time. I think that, they've got a gym full of young ladies right now that are really talented and really together as a team. And I think they're in line to do some special things. Our women's soccer program, I think, has built to a point now where we believe we're going to compete for postseason and Big Ten championships in the years ahead. So really good fall sport things happening. Again, the basketballs, we all know about them. They're going to continue to be really good. I think our men, obviously we weren't great last year as we were the year before, but we've got a team with no seniors on the men's side. And so this is a team that's going to be able to grow together for some period of time. And that's going to be exciting to watch because I've been fortunate to go down and watch practice and it is very competitive in the gym right now. I mean, all those talented guards that we've got, they can count. They know you can only play five guys at a time. There's only so many minutes to go around. So the competition is intense and it's fun to watch.
Awesome.
In the spring, I won't talk about them all, but I think our baseball team is, really, really developing a really nice talent base. Softball last year was off to a really positive start. I think they're moving in a really good direction. So I'm excited about some of our spring sport programs. And our track and fields have been really good the last several years, a sport you don't hear about that much, but we've got some really, really great and national level athletes in our track and field program. So lots of good things happening. And we just want to get back to business where we can have complete seasons, full seasons. And again, that's beyond our control, but we can't wait for that day to come.
Yeah, definitely a lot of excitement. And I was hoping to get up to a baseball game last year. I think there's a lot of excitement around that program. Like you mentioned, I had Greg Goff on the podcast last spring. I was really hoping to get up to a game before everything ended up going sideways on us last spring. But really excited about what Coach Goff is doing with the baseball team up there. Now, I also just want to say kudos to you and everybody up there involved in the athletic department. It seems like, from my perspective anyway, fan engagement, social, whether it's going to games, or the activity on engagement on social media, to me seems to be at an all-time high. So keep up the good work up there with that as well.
Well, thanks, Adam. And that's been a focus of ours is to try to be accessible, be available, and really show some of the energy and the excitement that exists here at Purdue. We've got so many good things. We've got so many talented people that are working hard on our behalf and trying to build a successful program to best tell that story is absolutely a goal of ours, and to make it available to people in whatever forms and mediums we can. We try to be as good as we can at that. And I think we've gotten better. Obviously, always room to improve, but I think we're in a better place than maybe we had been for a while.
Yeah, and another thing that I've noticed has trended up since you come on board, and this is not a slight on anybody before you in any means, but current 4-year average graduation success rate for your student athletes is at 86% with a 93% career placement rate. Talk about just the importance, again, emphasize the student athlete. Putting the student first.
We're really, really pleased with the progress, and this was coming. I mean, we've been good academically for a long time, and under Morgan Burke's leadership, we were moving in a direction of improvement and progress, and getting our numbers to a really good place. In fact, I think our graduation rate next year will be like 88. I mean, it's really coming to, we want to get to 90, and then to go beyond 90. That's our goal. Because when you bring a young person here, that is ultimately the objective, is to have them graduate with a degree from Purdue, and that's a tremendous value to them for a lifetime. And so the better we can be at that, then we're fulfilling our obligation and our commitment to them when we brought them here. So I'm really pleased with the progress. Lots of people work hard at that. Our coaches, our academic support folks, our student athletes take it seriously. They invest in that. They're expected to. I mean, that's not, you don't come to Purdue to be a student athlete to think you're going to mail it in on the academic side. That's not the way it works here. It's part of our fabric and who we are, and we don't run from that. We're proud of it. It's a source of pride for us. And last spring, for instance, our student athlete grade point average was 3.45, highest ever. In fact, it exceeded the general student body by a couple percentage points, which I think it was the first time in history that had ever happened. So again, our young people hold up their end of the bargain academically, and we're really proud of that.
And you mentioned the late Morgan Burke. Just talk about, taking what he's built and building upon that, and what you learned from him.
Yeah, and then that's exactly what my thought was when I was fortunate enough to be able to come to Purdue, is to walk into a place that had a tremendous foundation in place that Morgan over many years had led and put put the pillars, right where they needed to be. And for me, it was about trying to take that, build on the very best of it, and find opportunities to get better in areas that maybe we hadn't been able to focus on for a variety of reasons, or that have just evolved recently. So I am incredibly appreciative of that, of the mindset that had been developed here, of the soundness of the priorities that Morgan and our whole department operated under. Couldn't have asked for it to be any better. The stage was set, and it's our job to carry it now to the next, that next level of success. And we're working hard. It's not easy. We're working hard to do that each and every day.
Great. Thank you. Thanks for sharing that. A couple more things. Quickly, I want to hit on next week, an important week across our nation. Of course, we obviously got the presidential election, along with local elections as well. Talk about Purdue's involvement in this, and talking about the Get Out the Vote. You guys have used Twitter and athletes there to talk about the importance of Get Out the Vote, and then also the announcement of no practices, no events on Election Day, the moratorium there, along with Mackey Arena being available as a voting site. Talk about why Purdue thought that was important to get the voice out and important.
Sure. I mean, our student athletes, I think, wanted to, this is just one of the elements that I think they wanted to be impactful in. The Big Ten began a voting initiative, and one of the elements of that early on was surveying your current athletes to find out what percentage of them were already registered to vote. And we had a really strong percentage, and we've but even beyond that, we've continued to really push that as the very best way in our democracy to express yourself is to vote, is to not be left behind on election days. And our young people have taken that to heart. They've continued to tell that story and to really communicate that message out there, not only within their peer groups, but beyond in the broader community. And as a further piece of supporting that, we inquired early on about the possibility of using Mackey, and we went through the election board and all that, and got a favorable response. And the early voting day, we had incredible volume of people, excuse me, that were able to come out and vote. And we expect the same on Election Day next week. It's going to be a busy place. And again, we just wanted that, you know, Mackey Arena is such an iconic spot, and it sort of just further demonstrate our support for people getting out and voting. We wanted to have such a recognizable, you know, landmark space be used as a voting place. And I think it was a positive and good move.
Yeah. Especially just also that accessibility. I mean, for a lot of students and athletes up there, unless you're maybe a senior or a grad student, this is probably your first election, your first major election, at least anyway. Yeah. So just really cool that you guys have made that accessibility available for that.
Exactly. It's not a polling place that anybody has to wonder where the heck it is. Everybody knows where Mackey is. So that was one of the really good benefits.
Awesome. Well, I know we're kind of going along here. I just want to wrap this up. A couple of fun questions for you, sure. If you don't mind. I'm curious, your favorite moment in Purdue sports since joining Purdue University?
Wow. There's been a couple of them.
Feel free to name a few.
That Ohio State game, we talked about it already. Yeah. That's one that I think everybody sort of has that as a highlight and hard to top for all that went into that. And then you think back a little bit to the men's basketball 2 years ago down in Louisville in the Sweet 16 and the Elite Eight game. You know, two of the just best college basketball games you'll ever see one team play over a weekend. It was, just and beyond the game itself, the turnout of the Purdue fan base down in Louisville. I mean, we literally took over the city. We took over the Yum Center. I mean, it was Mackey Arena reincarnated in a different place. I mean, it was an amazing environment and just this tremendous outpouring of Purdue pride and support. Those are moments that to this day, they're just really special. You can't, I don't take it for granted. I don't think anybody should take it for granted. They don't happen by accident. People have to really be invested in something to show up and be part of those kind of moments. But boy, were they exciting. And again, to me, set the stage for more of those kinds of opportunities down the road. We will be in those environments again. And now that we know and have a taste for what it feels like, the next time we'll finish the job. And I think on the football side of things, we're going to have more nights like that and more opportunities to have big time, high impact games and hopefully come out on the right side of it. But those moments are in our future. I have no doubt about that.
Yeah, for sure. All right, let's wrap it up on this. Just something also that just recently happened this week. I know you grew up, you were a big baseball player yourself. Yeah. Yeah. Thoughts? You watch the World Series? You still stay tuned in?
I do. I love playoff baseball. I mean, Major League Baseball at playoff time is really, really, really good. Every pitch, every at bat, everything matters. And intensity just really ramps up. And I really enjoyed it. I mean, I really enjoyed it. I thought the quality of baseball, the excitement of some of the games was a really good thing for the sport, for just the sport of baseball. I think it was entertaining to watch. The games moved along, and I think it was a really just good stretch of time for baseball in general, and I hope that continues to carry over in the years ahead. But I really did get it. I had no rooting interest. I'm not a Dodgers guy. I'm not a Rays guy. I like good baseball, and I thought there was lots of it played here during these last few weeks. So it was great.
Yeah, for sure. I mean, as anybody who listens to the podcast, they know I'm a big Braves fan. So I was a little disappointed the week before when we lost in the 7-game series against the Dodgers. Yeah. But kudos to the Dodgers. I thought they really deserved it. You're from New York, right? Are you a Yankees guy?
You know what? I'm not. I was when you're growing up in New York, you got to be one or the other. You got to be Yankees or Mets. Everybody else was a Yankees guy when I was a kid, so I went Mets. I was a contrarian. Okay. I went Mets and then Red Sox on the American League side. Okay. And there was a reason for that. I mean, Red Sox, we got all their games over the air television from right across the Long Island Sound. Plus, Carl Yastrzemski, who grew up not far from me, happened to have a similar ethnic background as I did, was a great player for the Red Sox back in those days. And so I love Carl as a player, and on the Mets side, I love Tom Seaver as a player, and those were the guys that really got me hooked into those teams. And while the Red Sox have delivered some really good moments over the years, the Mets have been abysmal for a long time. So you know, while I still pay a little bit of attention, they've disappointed me so many times. It's hard to stay connected to them at this point.
Well, as a Braves fan in the NL East, I'm okay with the Mets' struggles for a little bit long.
I hear you.
No, that's awesome. I love it. Thank you for sharing that. I appreciate it. It was a great series. I'm glad they were able to get the season in, and I thought they did it pretty well. I mean, I thought the NBA has done it the best with the bubble. Yeah. You know, you can't do that when you have all 30 some teams, you know, involved in football or baseball. Yeah. But good to see, you know, these leagues taking the measures and able to give us fans something still to root for sure.
I agree, Adam.
Awesome. Well, Mike, I'm so grateful for your time. Thank you. Anything else that I didn't ask that you wanted to get out there?
No, I think we covered most of what's happened at this point in time. I appreciate the opportunity and to tell a little bit of what's going on. It's like for everybody in our world, this has been a really unusual set of circumstances. We have done our best to deal with it as it comes, and that's about all you can do. You know, every time you try to plan 2 or 3 days or a week out, you know, you get overcome by the next set of circumstances. Yeah. But you know, we've all learned to be flexible, to be adaptable, and if you're not going to do very well in these circumstances. So I think it's been a hard way to go for lots of people, and our coaches are creatures of habit, of routine, of structure, and when they don't have those three things, you know, they get anxious. But I'm proud of our folks. They have fought against the urge to try to know the unknowable, and have just done the very best with whatever they can get done that next day. And that's the best you can do at this point in time.
For sure. Yeah. We got some great leadership up there under President Daniels and the Protect Purdue plan up there as well to help us keep going in the right direction. I assume other universities are doing this as well, at least you hope. And hopefully, we continue to trend in the right direction and hopefully get to see all these sports eventually come back.
I'm with you. I can't wait.
Awesome. Mike, thank you so much for your time. I appreciate it.
All right, Adam. Thank you. Take care.
Boiler up.
Yes, sir. Boiler up.